I'd like to understand how autism unravels from the very beginning into adulthood. So I'm following, in a way, the ideas of Annette Karmeloff-Smith, who was a student of Jean Piaget, who said that the key to understanding developmental disorders is development itself. So we need to actually pay serious attention to development, as opposed to, in the past, a great deal of the research on developmental disorders has looked, in particular in MRI, it's looked at adults, mainly because they did not have the ability to actually scan children. So if we take development seriously, my version of this is that data mining in developmental disorders is analogous to panning for gold in the river of development. So basically, my picture of panning for gold, there's someone standing in a river panning for gold, and they find something, and it is the gem of a journal publication, but it doesn't easily relate at all to where the developmental disorder began, and you can't really interpret the result. So when you want to actually find the way to the real gold, you need to basically trace the river back upstream until the gold disappears, right? And that's a little bit of what I'm trying to do. So I will focus on autism, as Boris has introduced this. And so the autism is, as you know by now, a genetic disorder. It's a behaviorally defined disorder. It's a developmental disorder. It is largely a social reciprocity disorder, but it has a number of other features, like there are sensory abnormalities. They're very, very sensitive to touch and sound. They also have repetitive behavior aspects. Some hand flapping is often reported, and things like that. But it's very, very variable. It's a spectrum disorder, and it can take a form that is very much like your colleagues, or it can take a form that is much less functional, and that can include an inability to actually speak, or at least to respond in a way that is expected. Right. So Rain Man is the classic case, if you've seen that movie, the classic case of autism. So starting way downstream, panning for gold, this is a result, reduced network efficiency in ASD. And this is akin, I think, to a number of results that have been reported that have abnormal connectivity or underconnectivity in autism. And so I'm going to start here and then try and unravel what I mean by network efficiency. Right? That takes a little bit of detail. So I'd like you to consider these two networks. Right? They are very, very different, obviously. Right? The red network has many more long-distance connections than the blue network. And then I'd like you to consider how they differ in terms of manipulation. So the blue network, if I take the two A nodes and flip them, I have the red network. And so in terms of graph theory, these are identical, right? So graph theoretic mechanisms will never get you at this huge difference in organization. So we need tools that can actually deal with these differences in organization. We particularly need that if we're going to deal with differences that are related potentially to brain size, which will show up in autism, and also to differences in brain shape, as shows up in differences in race, for instance. So we need to deal with space. And that was the observation made by Latorre and in 2001. So Strogatz and Watts introduced graph theory to network analysis in 1998, and 3 years later, Latorre and Marchiori said, no, it's not really appropriate for brain science, right? Because brains are inherently spatial. And so they came up with a definition of efficiency, which introduced the notion of the distance between the nodes in the network. And this was crucial to their definition, crucial to their amendment to the use of graph theory for neuroscience. And it had this intuitive idea that the greater the physical distances, so the more long distance connections, the lower the efficiency of the networks. And so they defined this both for global and local connectivity. And for global connectivity, it really is asking how quickly, more or less, what's the travel time that I would need to go between any two nodes in the network. For local, the local version of efficiency, what they were defining was what is the travel time required for the neighbors of a node to communicate, right? And basically that looks like what you've probably standardly seen in graph theory. It's for a ring type structure and lattice, you have low global efficiency because you have to walk all the way around the outside of that ring, and you have high local efficiency because all the neighbors of a node are well connected to one another. If you instead randomize those connections, you increase global efficiency because you can take shortcuts across the network, but you decrease local efficiency because the neighbors of a node aren't necessarily well connected anymore. So with these definitions for efficiency, you can now look at this difference in network efficiency that previously under graph theoretic notions like characteristic path length and clustering coefficient would be identical, and now these definitions of efficiency pull these network structures apart. Okay. So the problem that people had with network efficiency in 2001 was that they didn't see a way to actually get the lengths of the connections. So people who were dealing with functional connectivity, they didn't see how they would get the lengths. There were people who used the Euclidean distance, but for something like the corpus callosum, for instance, that's wholly inappropriate. But there's a very straightforward way to get the length of the connections. We actually just had someone present us with a way. So diffusion data provides you that. So this is the pipeline that I'm using to compute the measures that I need for network efficiency. And you see that there are two colors on the arrows, a purple path and a yellow path, and the purple and yellow path, which means both ways of computing things, come through here, right? So basically what's common to both streams and the two different streams of processing are going to be one version of tractography is done in native space to get the length of the connections, and the other version of tractography is done in stereotaxic space to get the strength of connectivity. Because probabilistic tractography has a serious distance bias, and so if you want to mitigate that at least across subjects, you need to put all their data in the same space. So the first step, though, is to process the T1 data to create the masks for probabilistic tractography. So this is done, in my version, it's done by Civit, but it could equally well be done by FreeSurfer. All you're doing in the way I'm doing this is finding the white matter surface, the boundary between the white matter and the gray matter, and basically everything inside that is going to be seeded from, except for the CSF and the subcortical regions. So the CSF is found by the tissue classification, and the subcortical material is found by a fusion-based method that basically registers atlases of subcortical structure to each subject and votes, right? So we pull out the subcortical regions and the ventricles, and the other red around the outside is the stop mask, which is everything other than the white matter, right? So as opposed to a few seconds ago, I'm seeding from everywhere in the white matter and stopping at the ventricles and stopping at the subcortical material because I don't want fibers to actually go into the subcortical material and come back out and carry on to another connection. So I want only direct connections between any gray matter and any other gray matter. And if a connection enters the CSF, it will be discarded, right? So it's stopped. And then another level of this is to say, give me the connections that actually go from a region of interest to another region of interest. And then I compile that. So this is all done for the maps, the masks that are used for probabilistic tractography, and they are used both in native space and in stereotaxic space. The transformation that gets you to the MNI 152 is used to bring the diffusion data into stereotaxic space, or on this lower path, you leave it in native space. You generate all the probabilistic tracks that you have, and there are gazillions, because you're seeding, I seeded in this case 10,000 times from every voxel of the white matter, right? And so you have a massive number of streamlines, and you basically are recording the endpoints of each one of those streamlines, and then taking that through an atlas, any atlas, and basically using that to estimate the connectivity between all regions, the average connectivity, and the average length of the connections. So that's, that will give you a connectivity matrix that gives you the length of connections between every region and every other region in the atlas, and the strength of the connections between every region and every other region in the atlas. And the strength needs to be adjusted because the atlas has different sizes of regions, right? So you adjust that by the average area of the average surface area of the regions. So you now have the length and strength of the connections between all pairs of regions, and you can now go back to the Latorre and Marchiori definition. I've added an adjustment because their definition had it simply as a binary thing, right? So you use the distance, but it was just there was a connection or there was not, and the reality is that there are strong connections and weak connections. Ideally, in the future, this will actually bring into play the axon diameters, because what you're actually after is the speed of conduction or the conduction delays between all pairs of regions. But for the moment, it's the strength of connectivity which should relate to the myelination of the bundle or the bandwidth, right? And this gives you the intuitive result that basically if you have a network that has greater physical distances in it, that has lower efficiency. If you have a network that has greater strengths between the connections, that has higher efficiency. So it's more or less when you ask for the shortest route on your GPS, that's what you're getting, the quickest route, right? Yes? That's a good question. I should say that that is the shortest route, right? So the shortest route may involve multiple jumps, right? It's not the direct connection alone. It's saying I'm going to explore all pathways and choose the one that's the shortest. So like your GPS, it might find that the quickest way between two places is not the direct route, but it might take you onto the highway, which then takes you close and then back off again. Yes. And hopefully that would come out in terms of the strength of the connection. And if you took a less direct route, right, the one that doesn't actually exist, that would be a longer route and it would not be used in the calculation because the calculations of efficiency use only the shortest possible route, right, the fastest way to get between two things. And there is a cost to the synaptic connections, which is not part of this calculation, but it is far less than the actual conduction delays introduced by axons, right? So the axons between the two hemispheres could introduce hundreds of milliseconds delays, or, you know, on average 25 millisecond delays, right? But the synaptic connections are much shorter than that. Okay? With that definition now, what we're missing is only that we would like to not have a single measure for the whole brain, but we'd like to know the efficiency of every node, every brain region, right? So that's easily done because the definition was simply the average of the, it was averages in both the global case and the local case that just basically summed up the efficiency of each node, right? Or averaged the efficiency of each node. So in the case of nodal global efficiency, now you're just asking how quickly can this node communicate with all other regions of the brain? And in the case of nodal global efficiency, you're asking how efficiently can this node's neighbors communicate with one another? Okay? And that is what generated this result. And this result basically, once again, this is a t-statistic that is centered on zero, so if there were no difference between autism and controls, this whole map would be green, right? If there was ever a space where autistics showed greater efficiency, this map would be yellow or red in that region, but in all regions, it's blue, basically showing a reduction in efficiency everywhere in the brain, but to varying degrees. And those varying degrees, if you look at it in terms of what's statistically significant after correction for multiple comparisons, it's a large part of the brain that's actually significantly involved. Right? There's significant reductions widespread with, you know, some asymmetries that are potentially interesting, but very broad underconnectivity or inefficiencies. So I think, you know, I return to the idea that it's very, very difficult to interpret what this means when these are, on average, 34-year-old subjects, right? So how this actually relates to where autism begins or what to do about it is difficult, but I'm gonna try, right? So I'm gonna walk backwards. There's gonna be, you know, a heavy amount of speculation in what I'm saying. Warning. So I think that this relates to the brain overgrowth. At least in part, I think the brain overgrowth actually will explain the inefficiencies that are found in adults with autism. And I think that basically the reason for this is because development is a process of, it heavily involves pruning, but it's a process of building the most efficient device that it can build, given the trajectory that it's on, right? So the thing about autism is that the brain growth trajectory is accelerated, but it doesn't end up with larger brains in the end. So it sort of misguides the pruning process to say, I'm going to be a large brain, so you should trim me back to what you would expect a large brain to have in terms of long distance connections. But in the end, you end up with a normal adult-sized brain. So, if you look across species, you see that, so this is a squirrel monkey, this is 11 different species of primates, and you see this really solid relationship. The larger the brain is, the less the long-distance connectivity is, so the CC is the corpus callosum. So as the brain increases across these species, and there are massive differences, you see less and less interhemispheric connections, right? And so these interhemispheric connections, by the way, we know that these are established early in development. So there's been a study in Rhesus macaque where they looked at, they sacrificed 22 Rhesus macaques, and basically the amount of connectivity that was retained shortly postnatally was about two-thirds of connections were pruned early in development in the rhesus macaque. So that's the sculpting that's going on early in development. And yeah.
But is it also true that as you look at different species going
Yes, we're more and more and more connected, and there's a difference between that in short distance connectivity and long distance connectivity. So there's increasing amounts of short distance connectivity and decreasing amounts of long distance connectivity as you get bigger and bigger brains. Yeah. Which I'm suggesting is actually related to the efficiency of the long distance connections. So as you make bigger brains, those long distance connections take, they have very long conduction delays, right? Unless you compensate for that by building larger diameter axons, right, and so forth. But if you try and build larger diameter axons in general, you run into the problem that that makes you have to have a bigger brain, right? And if you have to have a bigger brain, the connections become longer, so it's not a solution to the problem, okay? So you have to make a choice, and the choice that's apparently been made in evolution has been to retain more short distance connections and get rid of more long distance connections and organize the brain in a way that is like what has often been referred to as the rich club, right? So you form these clusters with quick communication between those clusters, but slow communication between any one of the nodes in the cluster and any other node elsewhere. So you have to go through that organization. Well, no, that would be the conduction delay, which would be a part of the efficiency. Yes, absolutely. But it's like it loses the network aspect of it. So, but yes, that is the basis. You would like to be able to estimate the conduction delays between locations and use that. So, I mean, in terms of diffusion data, the axon diameter will help get better estimates of that. With AxCaliber data, that it's actually been shown that there's a good relationship between the length of the connections, the caliber, the axon diameter, and the conduction delays. The actual conduction delays measured with EEG. So when I was actually collecting, okay. So the individual connections are. It is really about the conduction delays between them, but if you want to build a network out of these, then you are asking, so at a local level, sorry, at a local level, you're asking how much time it takes to communicate between the individual nodes within this cluster, right? And if you build connections that are long distance, right, then you've added a conduction delay there. And if there's a neighbor that's far away that needs to communicate with each one of the other neighbors that are nearby, then that's a very inefficient organization. So you wouldn't build a community where one portion of the community takes days to get to, right? You build a spatially local cluster, right? So it's related to modularity, I think. And like this idea that you build tightly packed, spatially compact modules that then have a communication to another module, but the local packing, the local clustering is really, really important to the efficiency, to the local efficiency of that network. But the which of
Well, I agree because I am also confused.
Okay.
And I think the word efficiency is what is buzzing in my head in a wrong way.
Okay.
Because I don't understand efficiency for what. Because I agree, a long distance connection is not necessarily bad at transmitting information. It can be very efficient at transmitting information. They're actually large caliber axons. For example, I have a peripheral nerve all the way to my toe, and if I step on something, it's going to hurt.
So right. We're relating back to an idea from long ago of minimal wiring, right? So it's very related. like. So you don't have extra, so the minimal wiring idea was that you build the brain with the shortest paths possible, right? Of course, minimal wiring, really minimal, would be nothing. But that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about if you're going to have a functionally, you know, a functional brain, you build it with the shortest path lengths that you can build. And you put functional modules together in a way that they can communicate well to one another if they are, you know, if they are often used together. So you wouldn't separate out functional modules that have to communicate to do really common tasks. You wouldn't put them in opposite sides of the brain, opposite ends of the
but
brain.
Isn't this the whole idea of the small world network, that just a few long-range connections increases the overall efficiency of communication of your entire network? And thus, long-range connections are not only efficient, but they're actually a requirement for the global efficiency of the network.
Absolutely, I agree. I'm not saying that long-distance connections are bad. I'm saying that you wouldn't have excess of them, right? So the small world network is the idea that you build these clusters with super highways between them, right? You don't have every node within this cluster talking to every node within this cluster, but you trim down your long distance connectivity so that you organize it through hubs, mm-hmm. right? So if you have these extra connections, right, that creates an inefficiency.
If you measure some type of cognitive processes and the intervention of the different structures and the fibers that connect these structures, you will find that long connections are very, very efficient because the process is not so much delay as if you have the intervention of very short connections. Because, for example, you can see this in the event-related potentials. In the event-related potentials, you can see one response, it has much more delay when it corresponds with responses from short connections. Short connections are characterized by being those that have the most difficult and of high efficiency during cognition. But if you note the large connections, then you see that the large connections precede all the time what happened for the short connections, all the time. So I am a neurophysiologist. And then
let me back up a mile then and say, when I was first doing this work, I was collecting EEG to put together with the diffusion data to measure the conduction delays between regions, right? So I definitely agree that that's the kind of conduction delay that you want to measure. And the long distance connections can be, so in the visual cortex, uniquely in the visual cortex, there are these huge fibers, they're actually colossal fibers, and they actually maintain the same conduction delay across species that are vastly different in brain size, because it's so important that you be able to actually avoid a predator, right? So your visual cortex does make these kinds of compensations. But if you have a larger brain, the frontal cortex, like the long distance connections in the frontal lobe, do not make that kind of compensation. And so they just become slower in a larger brain.
Larger brain has been related with more intelligence.
Yes.
Einstein has a great brain.
And it actually, so.
And microcephalos have a terrible problem.
Right, but I'm not saying that removing the long distance, like the whole process of pruning these long distance connections is to make the most efficient structure that you can. So all I'm saying is that you organize the brain differently if it's small than if it's large. So when you look at the gender differences, right? There's actually, they're not gender differences in brain organization. So the statement that that women have more connections across the back of the corpus callosum, for instance, that turns out to not be male versus female, but to be a brain size issue. So you actually just have this steady relationship across individuals that the larger the brain is, the smaller the number of long distance connections, across the corpus callosum at least. But that doesn't mean that it's less efficient, right? That just is a different organization.
I think efficiency, what I mean about efficiency, is related with the process of information. And if yes. You are taking into account, for example, psychological process and psychophysiological process, then you will see that the short connections are related with the more relevant both more delay. So what is the efficiency? Because the efficiency, it's...
Well, I think maybe there's like just efficiency in terms of timing, so that you have very slow conduction delays, but you could also think about efficiency in terms of the use of physical mass to achieve a system that has the same amount of information processing. And maybe that's also what you're referring to, and that's why you prune long-range connections more.
So that's good. That's another force that I that is at play, but it's not. So I'm working off of the original definition of efficiency by Latour and Marchiori, and that wasn't part of it, but that is a really important part of the metabolic processes are driving the pruning that is actually going to create fewer long distance connections in larger brains and is probably very, very relevant to autism, right? But the efficiency, so efficiency of a network organization, so if we go back to the network structure that I showed before, that is, like the network efficiency definition is meant to distinguish between these extra long distance connections that serve really no purpose. So if I flip those nodes back and I have then just a series of short distance connections, that organization is more efficient because it involves fewer long conduction delays, which the conduction delays across the brain are 25 milliseconds to hundreds of milliseconds. So it's just a question of reorganizing the brain so that areas that communicate a lot have the have less conduction delays between them. No? So I'll try. We'll see where that goes. So the reasoning, so we've already sort of been there. On the one hand, there's the conduction delays, which are in large part a function of length. Diameter would come into play, but when you look across species, it actually doesn't seem to. So you can go between species that are vastly different in size and so in the length of the connections, but the diameter of the fibers, the fiber distribution diameter, does not change, barely at all. So certainly not enough to actually compensate for the increased size. There's also the metabolic costs, as Boris was saying. So having even just the one thing of having to carry an action potential across a long fiber, it's very, very expensive, right? So on the one hand, you can compensate for that with myelin, but you really are always dealing with the fact that you have increased metabolic costs with membrane surface area. And then there's also the aspect of it actually costs cellular material to build, right? So there are all these forces that I think are operating during development that establish that you should, to the extent you can, eliminate the long fibers, right? And I think that's what underlays the 66% reduction in long distance connections that was seen in rhesus macaque monkeys and like the general developmental pruning. And the end result that with increased brain size, we end up with greater amount of white matter, but fewer long-distance connections, relatively speaking. So to sort of experiment with that, I used some computational modeling to say, could this actually explain the underconnectivity that's been reported in autism, the network inefficiencies? And so these computational models, they're very, very trivial brains with two hemispheres. The inputs to the two hemispheres are independent, the outputs are independent, and they are twins, right? They're identical, they're initialized identically, and the only difference between these twins is that they're growing either according to the head circumference trajectories of typical developing kids or the trajectories of autistic kids. And so that means basically that you start training this thing and then you introduce differences in the interhemisphere connection lengths, right? And the differences in the interhemisphere connection lengths are simply a function of the head circumference. So you have slightly longer connections in the networks that are growing according to the autistic growth trajectory than you do in the ones that are growing according to the normal growth trajectory, and not any difference in the interhemispheric links. So that's the only difference between these, and then I grew hundreds of these twins across this time period. And the training set was basically something that would be ambiguous for a single hemisphere. So the left hemisphere would see this input, so this, 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 and this, and the target for that hemisphere would be four-way ambiguous, right? And the right hemisphere was necessary to disambiguate that. So if you had both the inputs from the left and right hemisphere, you could get a unique answer. So the interhemisphere connections were critical. And when you trained this, grew this way, what you saw was that basically the networks that were growing according to the typical growth trajectory showed an increase in the importance of the interhemisphere connections over time, steady growth. And the networks that were growing according to the autistic growth trajectory, and again, that's the only difference between the networks, they showed an initial increase in the importance of the interhemisphere connections and then a decline, right? And so I'm suggesting that basically this is some support for the idea that the growth trajectories that we see in autism could actually establish fewer long distance connections. So using an idea that had been used in the literature, which is that intracranial volume is an index of the largest brain size achieved at any point during development, I looked back at this same data. So in this case, I related the efficiency. I no longer am looking at the group difference. I'm looking at the relationship between network efficiency across all individuals and their intracranial volume. So supposedly their maximum brain size during development. So what you see is that the larger the intracranial volume, so the larger the brain size during development, the greater the reduction in network efficiency, both locally and globally. And I think more interestingly is to compare this with that. Okay, so this, we have that again? Nope. So this with that, right? So one of these is the relationship between network efficiency and intracranial volume, and the other is the group difference between autism and control, right? Same subjects, right? And when you look at the correlation of the t-statistics for the two analyses, the local relationship, the correlation is 0.98, and the global relationship is 0.95. So again, I think this is supporting the idea that the larger the brain size during development, the more reduced the efficiency, both locally and globally. So that question is, where does the brain overgrowth come from? Okay, so now we're going to go way, way upstream. And so this, I have the good fortune to be involved in the infant brain imaging study, which has collected data on the infant siblings of children with autism. So in the normal population, there are, it's about 1 in 68 children that are born with autism. But if a couple has a child with autism and are having another child, the likelihood of that child developing autism is 15 to 20%, somewhere in there. And so that allows you to collect a reasonable sample size without collecting millions of scans, right? So that's what they took advantage of. They collected T1, T2 diffusion data, and a bunch of behavioral data. And as a first look at this, I'm going to show you what a student at the MNI has done. This is work from Alonso Cardenas de la Parra, however you say that properly. And what he's done is a tensor-based morphometry study. So he has taken all of the six-month data, every six-month baby, and created a template from that, and every 12-month baby and created a template from that, right? So nonlinear registrations to the template. And so he has a 24-month template, a 12-month template, and a six-month template, and he has all of the transformations that get you from the individual babies to the templates, right? So then you can look at the Jacobian of the nonlinear transformation, and it gives you a measure at every voxel of how much that voxel had to shrink or grow to match up to the template, right? So you have that for every baby and every voxel. You have a measure of shrinkage or growth. And then he's fit a linear mixed effects model to that data to establish what the trajectories are for each of the groups. So the red here is, these are the infants with autism that go on to develop autism. The yellow are the infants who are high risk but do not develop autism, and the blue are the control babies, right? And so what you see is that the babies who go on to develop autism show this increased rate of growth, and he showed this in many areas, but the increased rate of growth is in areas that are further removed from sensory processing, right? So association areas, these are the connections, this is through the genu, of the corpus callosum, and you see this increased growth there and in other association areas. As opposed to, if you look at this spot in the visual cortex, you see the reverse. The babies with that went on to develop autism actually show reduced growth in sensory regions. So now I want to take another gigantic leap and say why I think this might be happening. So now I go back to the efficiency analysis, but I do this in the babies. So, and I'm going to concentrate on the first year of life. The problem that I have in the first year of life is the data, right? So if you look at the six-month data, you can see that the contrast is terrible, and trying to actually get the masks necessary for probabilistic tractography is quite difficult. But the 12-month data is good enough for that. So you can put surfaces on the white matter and get the subcortical material and get the ventricles and create the mask that you need for probabilistic tractography, and then use a nonlinear transformation to bring it back from the 12-month to the 6-month data. Okay, so that's what I've done, and then gone through the process of calculating network efficiency. And I have network efficiency, network efficiency on every node in these babies at both time points in the longitudinal data, and I fit a linear mixed effects model to that data and generate the interpolated data in between. So I've now assessed network efficiency, the group difference in network efficiency with the data centered at 6 months, 9 months, and 12 months, and that's what you're looking at there. So you can see, first of all, that even at 6 months of age, you have reductions in network efficiency, right? In the right temporal lobe in particular, and that carries on through the first year of life. And you see an increase in, or a decrease in the T statistic in the left hemisphere as well. And so looking at what's actually statistically significant after correction for multiple comparisons, we see that basically the right temporal lobe, primary auditory cortex on the right, areas heavily involved in early language acquisition are involved. And by 9 months of age, you have the left primary auditory cortex, and by 12 months, also the insula on the left. So we don't have data young enough to actually see where autism begins, right? It begins presumably somewhere before 6 months of age, right? But we have sort of narrowed in on what areas of the brain are involved, right? And another look at what areas of the brain are involved comes from saying, okay, I'm gonna look at the relationship now to severity rather than just the group difference. That allows me also to use all of the high-risk kids, high-risk autism and high-risk non-autism. So that's what this relationship is. And you see again that you have a negative relationship. T statistic is negative in most places. And what a negative relationship means here is that the lower the efficiency, the greater the symptom severity, right? And if you look at where this is significant, after correction for multiple comparisons with false discovery rate, you see at 6 months of age already, you're involving the left primary auditory cortex, you're involving the right superior temporal gyrus, and as you move forward in time, you're involving further low-level processing areas, more of the auditory processing regions, secondary processing. You start to actually see something like the outline of the arcuate fasciculus, but also you see the involvement of the primary auditory cortex on the left, and by the time you're at 12 months of age, you have both visual cortices, left and right, you have both primary auditory cortices and surrounding auditory processing areas, and you also have the somatosensory strip on the left. So all low-level processing areas, no high-level processing areas. And so, I mean, I think that on its own tells you some interesting things about where you should think about intervening in autism, that you need to think about what it is that's going wrong in sensory processing regions. But it also suggests, I think, an answer to the pattern of brain overgrowth, what's going on in the morphometry data, right? So I'm speculating, again, that basically the reductions in efficiency within the sensory processing regions will have repercussions. And those repercussions will be, noise will be communicated into secondary processing and third tertiary processing areas. And that noise will interfere with the normal pruning process, right? It will be delayed, right? And so if the normal pruning process is delayed, that material will still be there and basically look like brain overgrowth in regions that are further from sensory processing areas. So just in sum, we have sensory inefficiencies already by 6 months of age in autism. These inefficiencies may underlie the brain overgrowth. The brain overgrowth may drive still greater inefficiencies because of the excessive pruning due to the larger brain. And so basically the really important thing, I think, is that the intervention, we should be looking to do that before the brain overgrowth actually occurs, because if it is driving excessive pruning, there's no real way to recover from that. So just to thank my colleagues and funders, and thank you.
Much, John, and there was already a good discussion while you were giving the talk. I just have one little question before, if I may. So, because otherwise I'll forget about it. My question relates to the last study that you've shown, where you have high-risk kids, and they were siblings of the individuals that were ultimately diagnosed with autism, I suppose, right? So you...
No. So, sorry. The recruiting strategy is there is a child with autism, so there's the high-risk distinction, high-risk, low-risk.
Okay.
So the controls are always, they do not have a familial history of autism.
Okay.
And if...
Okay, so there's no dependencies.
There's the occasional child that actually develops with autism, they're not included in the control group, right? So the high-risk group, they have an older sibling who's not in the study,
okay,
right, but they have
okay,
autism.
Okay, all right. So you don't have a nesting in the data structure that you could correlate?
No.
Maybe the
No, they're all independent.
Okay, all right. Yeah. Dr. Harmony?
To account IQ in severity?
No, severity is an independent measure. Severity is computed, it's a weighted score based on the ADOS scores, right? So this goes, it picks particular subsets of questions that that basically have been weighted and controlled for across different modules of assessment, and then it puts that through another lookup table that scores severity between 1 and 10, right? IQ, it's an interesting question. I haven't looked at how IQ relates.
Are there further questions? Yes.
Hi. Is there any information about if this brain overgrowth is related to neuron cells or glial cells, which explains this efficiency?
So there really is very little on that. There has been a very small amount of histology, and there have been claims that the brain overgrowth is driven by an extra proliferation of neurons. I don't think that result is actually very trustworthy because the data are from older individuals, right? So it's unclear whether that result would come from differences in apoptosis or whether it had to be an original difference. So I think we're still waiting for the answer at that level.
But yeah, thanks.
Great question.
Further questions? I have maybe one more. You showed the correlation between ICV and network efficiency markers, and you showed that the contrast between autism and controls is the same as, or basically similar to the correlation. Did you expand on this work a bit by looking maybe at more local markers of volume or of surface area and correlated those to the network efficiency markers derived from diffusion imaging measures?
Good idea. We can do that. Okay. So no, I haven't related those measures. We have done, we've looked at cortical thickness over the Abide data and shown changes, but it's really, we have never related that to intracranial volume, partly because it's difficult to get intracranial volume on the Abide data. Mm-hmm. But yeah, it's a good idea.
Okay. If there are no further questions, we could thank Dr. Lewis and...